Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east.
Yet the rescuing gift is not exactly parallel to the death-dealing sin.
Because you did it to the least of my brothers and sisters, you did it to me. Our hymns and our readings have already alluded a lot to the notion of sin. And so it's fitting that at the very outset of Lent, we put this notion before us. We don't wait, but we do it here and now because, in a certain sense, it's central to what Lent is about. But it's not only sin, it's also the notion of temptation and also the notion of repentance. Those three things go together: temptation, sin, and repentance. Those of us who are older maybe remember Flip Wilson and his famous expression, "The devil made me do it." Remember that? Well, the fact of the matter is, the devil can't make us do anything. He can tempt us, he can coach us or coax us, but the devil, even the devil, can't make us do anything because of our free will. So in a certain sense, that expression is not valid. It's not true, first of all. Secondly, it's not valid. I thought it might be interesting just to see what Merriam-Webster in the dictionary has to say about temptation, and I found that he really encapsulates what temptation is all about, so I'm going to share that with you. He says, "Temptation is the desire to perform an action that one may enjoy immediately or in short term, but probably later will regret for various reasons." He mentions legal, where we break the law of God, or civil law, social, where we hurt other people, let's say, psychological, for example, having to deal with guilt, and some people are very guilt-ridden, we know, health-related, which would be examples of that, of course, would be our addictions and what they do to us if we continue to fool around with addictions. And finally, he said economic, and the first thing that comes to mind, of course, is gambling. That would be another form of addiction. So I think this is a really good definition because it tells us what it is and what the effects are of sin. And we see them all over, all the time. Just read the newspaper and we see the effects of sin all the time. It's there. It cannot be ignored or avoided. Now, temptation can be looked at another way, and that is that it's a test. In the Old Testament, it said God tested Abraham. Abraham is the father of our faith. And it was a number of times through the life of Abraham that God put him to the test. The famous one, the incredible one, is where, having given him and Sarah a son, Isaac, God said to him, "I want you to sacrifice Isaac. Offer him up." And Abraham couldn't believe this. He didn't question God, he didn't argue with God, he just simply went about doing what God asked him to do. And at the very moment that he was going to sacrifice Isaac, we know that an angel came and held him back. That was a strange thing for God to do, but it was, you might say, the final, ultimate, greatest test that Abraham could have been given, because he said, "That's the only child I have, and how can there be a posterity if this son of mine dies?" He passed the test once again. So it's a test to help us conquer sin. It's a test that doesn't weaken us, but it strengthens us so that we can come out of the experience stronger for having had it. That's true in athletics and preparing for all kinds of events like that. We have to go through all kinds of exercises or tests in order to be successful, to be victorious. It is a test. And in the gospel today, Jesus was tested not once, but three times. Three times. Because he was very clear in what it is that God wanted of him. And Satan was trying to send him in another direction. All of these things look very, very appealing, but they were not what God wanted of him. He passed that test. I have a few quotes here from an article I read this week on this gospel reading, which I think was an excellent article and has some really good insights, and so I'd like to lift a few of those up and just comment on them. The first one is this. It says, "Every act of sin we commit participates in a tacit agreement to worship something or someone other than God. The important word there is tacit, a tacit agreement, kind of a quiet one, kind of an agreement we make with ourselves, oh, it's not going to be all that bad, I'm going to go do it anyway type of thing. It's a tacit agreement in which we worship something or someone other than God. It's an offense against God. Plain and simple, that's what it is. And so what Lent does, it invites us to recall Jesus' response to sin in today's gospel. It was his no to Satan, which should be our no to Satan whenever we are tested and when we are ever tempted. And that's part of life. It'd be nice if we wouldn't be, but God allows us to be tested. And having passed the test, we come out better people and stronger people than we were before. Penance, or repentance, is essential. It's a response to sin. Because sin is easy. It's easy to commit. It's easy to forget. It's easy to pretend it never happened or to explain it away. And penance says, you can't do that. We've got to come back and face it. We've got to do something about it. And we just can't pretend it away. A lot of people will do that. Just say, well, let's just forget about it. Sin flourishes when we cannot name it, says this author, for what it is or what it pretends not to be. If we can't name it or pretend it didn't exist, that's another way of dealing with it. Someone one time said that Satan's greatest victory is for us to pretend that he doesn't exist. If evil itself doesn't exist, that really gets us off the hook. That's his greatest victory. He doesn't want us to be aware of his presence. He doesn't want us to think about him. Just forget about him. And then suddenly this problem of evil seems to somehow lessen or go away. Sin draws us away from God, says the author, and directs us to nothingness. It can be so hard to let go, especially if we're caught in habitual sin. It's so hard to let go. Not impossible, but from experience we know it's very difficult. It can take place on a personal level. For example, we can be angry with someone. We can rage at the person. We can engage in gluttony, let's say, whether it's food or drink. We can gossip. That would be personal, but it can also be social. For example, indulging in internet pornography, which is so common today, it's an epidemic. We can indulge in that, but we forget that we're supporting human trafficking of children, or of women, or even of other men. We indulge in that. We support it, not directly, but indirectly. We forget that that person, whether it's a child or an adult, is a child or a person of God. God dwells in that person, and we are taking advantage of that individual for our own personal pleasure. And that's wrong. It's wrong. Because we don't respect our own humanness, our own sexuality, and we don't respect that of another individual. It is very, very wrong. Even though it's so common, even though it's so easy, even though it's in our own homes, because of the computer or the internet, that doesn't make any difference. Years ago, you'd have to go somewhere, or you'd have to read something, or you'd have to buy something. Today, it's right there. We get caught up in it and it becomes habitual. It is wrong. Jesus shows us the rational response to sin by refusing to turn from life and from God. So when we sin, we're actually not only turning away from God, but from the fullness of human life. It makes us less than what God wants us to be. Acts of penance, on the other hand, are a response to sin by refusing to turn from life and from God. It's to choose life. It is to choose God when we do penance. And so acts of penance aren't meant simply to burden us. In fact, it's just the opposite. Acts of penance free us, brings that freedom, and Jesus means freedom, that he wants each one of us to enjoy. But we can't do that unless we face the reality of sin and then do something about it. And so it's important then to realize, even though I've said all this and it's kind of heavy, that Lent is really a time of joy. a time of rejoicing because we are freeing ourselves. And not only that, we're looking ahead to what's coming, Holy Week, Jesus' life, his death, and his resurrection, and you and I are intimately involved in that dying process to ourselves, to our sinfulness, so that we can come to new life in Christ, not only at Easter, but already here in the season of Lent, the beginning of Lent. And so, making this practical, saying it can be kind of pie in the sky, the parish liturgical people and others, human concerns people, have come up with, other years and this year too, something in response to Matthew 25. If you look at Matthew 25, it's the end of his gospel, toward the end of his gospel, and it's the judgment scene. And the basic line is, because you've done it to me. I was hungry, I was thirsty, I was alone, I was in jail, I was sick, and you came to me. You fed me, you clothed me, you gave me shelter, you visited me. Because you did it to the least of my brothers and sisters, you did it to me. This can be a perfect form of penance, because now we're not thinking of ourselves, we're thinking of others. And on the back, you've got, if you haven't seen it, it's pretty hard to miss, a large cross draped with a purple cloth. And on there are little packets that you can take with you, our suggestions, very specific suggestions in terms of what we can do, not for ourselves so much, but for others by way of penance. They can be individual, they can be family-oriented, they can be things we do maybe just once or twice, we could do throughout Lent, we could do the rest of our lives. So I would suggest that you take a look at that. Very practical and very easy. Or come up with your own, but do it now. Let's not wait, let's do it now. What am I going to do by way of penance for my own sinfulness? Each one of us has our choice, whatever seems to make sense. You know, I'm going to give up candy. Well, that's not that hard. You know, I give up chocolates. I'm giving up chocolates. I love chocolates. But I got to do more than that. That's not enough. And we're not doing it just to diet. That's not enough. So I'm going to do something that kind of hits home. There's one other thing after the announcements this morning. Rob is going to come up representing Catholic Relief Services, which is my favorite in terms of helping people who are poor throughout the world, people who are in trouble, people who are in the midst of turmoil, natural disasters. It's a great kind of support for other people elsewhere. And he's going to say a little bit about that, and then we come with our little baskets or those little things that we use at piggy banks during Lent. And he'll say more about it then. And so we go back to the way we began. What is Lent all about? It's a joyous season that leads us somewhere. We're journeying, not alone, but together as people of faith. But it's about change. Change means life. And that's exciting. And Jesus says, come and follow me because I will give you the fullness of life. But we, in turn, have to do something ourselves and to be able to say no to ourselves so that we can say yes to our Lord.